My name is Emily Neuberger, and I am so excited to be here with this at this salon with you tonight. I am an author. This is my debut novel. It's called A Tender Thing. It came out actually about a month ago, right? Not when this all started, but a couple weeks after we all started lockdown, which is not exactly the most ideal timing, but it's been really interesting to experience my debut novel coming out while the world has been in such an historically interesting time. I also previously worked in publishing in editorial at Viking Books. And as Rochelle mentioned, I'm a mentor with Girls Right Now. And I'm completing my first year as a mentor right now. And I've had such a wonderful time with this organization. I've admired it for years, ever since I started working in publishing and I heard about Girls Right Now for the first time. And then I signed up to be a mentor as soon as I had a novel coming out and I felt like I had something I wanted to share with young women. And it's been such an incredible experience to be a mentor, which feels like it's really about what you can give to the teenagers, but also it's amazing to be on the receiving end of like seeing so much incredible writing from these young people and going to these workshops with this energy, with all these young high school students who have so much to say and such creative ways of saying it. And I couldn't recommend the experience more highly. So if you want to sign up to be a mentor, if you're interested, or if you are interested in being a mentee and you're attending this workshop right now, the sign up June. So please, it's really a wonderful organization. I'm gonna talk a little bit about my novel now. It's called A Tender Thing, as I mentioned, and it is set in 1958 in the world of Broadway musical theater. I chose that year specifically because that was when Broadway musicals were really in their golden age. Although that kind of implies that musicals are no longer in a golden age and like good work isn't being created anymore, which is not true. But that was when there were so many writers and a lot of things were being produced and really solidifying the art form into a popular piece of American culture. And choosing to set a novel in that time really leads us into talking about historical fiction. And I've always been attracted to historical fiction as a reader because you are sort of time traveling while also staying in the present. And you're looking at a story from two perspectives, right? You're looking at it from when the characters are living in this case in 1958, and you're also reading it in 2020. So you're thinking about how things might be different now than they were then. So A Tender Thing is about a young woman who moves from Wisconsin to New York to star in a Broadway musical that's being written. It's about the rehearsal process and how you write a musical and how you get it from the rehearsal studio all the way to Broadway. And the musical is controversial because it is the first interracial musical on Broadway starring a Black man and a white woman who fall in love, and that's depicted on stage, seeing them fall in love with each other. And again, I chose 1958 because it was a time right before the civil rights movement and feminism movements of the 60s. So it's right on the verge of these ideas becoming really a part of the American consciousness. And in the theater scene, which was a very transgressive and progressive place, these ideas were being thought about and talked about a couple years earlier than they might have been brought to the rest of the country. So, that's why I love historical fiction, is because it takes you on this journey and can teach you something about the past. And it also can teach you about, you know, how ideas came to be, how change came to happen, like how the world you live in now began to be possible. I'm gonna read a little section from A Tender Thing, which is from the very beginning, about 20 pages into the book. The main character's name is Eleanor, and she and her best friend Rosie have just taken the train to New York City and ran away from home so that she can attend a Broadway audition. And they meet a sailor named Tommy in a diner because they're lost in Manhattan for the first time, and they have nowhere to go and they don't know how to get to their hotel. So he is walking them through New York City. I'm Eleanor O'Hanlon, she nodded at Rosie. This is my friend, Rosie Hughes. How nice to meet you. Tommy spoke so politely that you could hear the training behind it, as if his mother were manipulating the words right out of him. Where are you ladies from? Wisconsin. So which one of you wants to be an actress? Eleanor's heart flared. He would assume it was Rosie, because that was what people did. How do you know Eleanor wants to be an actress? Rosie asked. Girls like you only come here to visit family, get married, or audition for the shows. He turned his head to check the traffic, and Eleanor caught a whiff of tobacco. Girls like us? Rosie said, her practiced flirt coming out. Nice girls, Tommy said, with no idea what they're doing. That's not true, Eleanor said. Women must come here for other reasons. But you are auditioning for a musical, aren't you? He winked. Eleanor shut her mouth and focused on her surroundings. They were coming up on a park that was about a city block long on each side and surrounded by tall buildings. When they crossed the street, they entered to cut through it. Don't come here at night, Tommy said. Is this Central Park? Rosie asked. Because I know we're not supposed to go there at night. Central Park is up farther, Tommy said. This is Bryant Park. It was nice of him not to point out how obvious this was. Eleanor hadn't known its name, but even she knew this place wasn't big enough to be the famous Central Park. The Broadway Theater should be about a block away. Eleanor felt their proximity. Would they be enormous or small? It would be lovely if they were small. Can we keep going? Eleanor asked. We're supposed to take 6th Ave uptown, Tommy said. I know, but we're so close. I want to see them. He gave Eleanor a curious look. The theaters! Tommy acquiesced, and they continued walking and were soon coming up on Broadway. Eleanor felt the moisture leave her mouth. All down her arms, her skin prickled, and her hands went cold. Look to your right, Eleanor, Tommy said with a smile in his voice. Times Square. In the movies, the ingenue always lifted her arms as if she could take in the whole world. Eleanor herself had planned to spin and yelp when she reached Times Square. She directed her first entrance to New York dozens of times in her mind, but all she could do was stare. Her eyes filled with tears. She raised her hands to her mouth. It was the most colorful place in the world. There were painted signs covering every surface. A giant Canadian Club whiskey billboard stared her in the face, but it was blocks away. Neon letters mounted on scaffolding advertised beer, cigarettes, Kleenex, television, clubs with names that made Eleanor blush. Enormous statues of Pepsi bottles sat on the roof of a clothing store. It was as if she'd walked onto the pages of a catalog. Then she looked at each of the storefronts and saw the marquees. Even just seeing the theaters, sleepy during the daytime, made Eleanor feel like she'd met her heroes. And that's where I'll stop. Thank you. So I worked on this novel for about 2 years before I sent it out to agents. And I just say that because I think sometimes the process of writing a novel or getting published can seem really opaque and difficult, and like there's a thousand steps between where you want to be and where you are. But really the majority of the work is done on your own at home by yourself writing. And only once you have a manuscript can you even think about all those things. And it's really important to just remember that every single person who's ever written a book wrote it by themselves on their own in their room. And or at the library or wherever. But if that's something that you want to do, the first step is to write. And my first draft, I was really not happy with. And it took a long time of going over it and just continuing to put in time and write and research and just like keep plugging away at it until I was proud of the draft that I had, and then start the process of the business side of things, the details, and writing a query letter, which is really similar to a cover letter to find an agent, and then working with them. And it's really, the most important thing is to have a manuscript. And so we're going to talk a little bit about how you begin thinking of a character today and begin thinking of research. Now, historical fiction is different than contemporary fiction because you have to think about the differences between then and now, obviously. And that often requires a lot of research, which can seem daunting. So if you're trying to think about, if you wanted to write, for example, my mentee wrote a story set in World War II for the end of the year, Girls Right Now Live. And she, at first it was like, how do you set something in World War II? There's all kinds of things you have to think about. But slowly we started building the steps of the questions she had to answer in order to flesh out her story and make it make sense and be both historically accurate and so that she could feel like she knew enough of the research that she didn't have to think about it all the time. And she could just write from the character's perspective because it's fiction. It's not a textbook. So you wanna know the information and have the information in your head, but you don't walk down the street thinking about, well, we do think about who's president of the United States nowadays, but normally it's like you're thinking about what you're going to have for lunch or if you're going to see your friend later that day. And people in the past were doing that kind of thing too. So it's this balancing act of having this historical information that you can like dress your set with as if you're designing a theater piece or a film, but knowing it and then letting it go so that you can write people who feel authentic to any time period. So I don't know if anybody has questions about the novel process that we could discuss a little bit before going on to talk a little bit more about the exercise. And you're welcome to put them in the chat if you do have questions, or about Girls Right Now in general, or just being a writer. I don't know if anyone has any questions. Yeah.
I can just ask it out loud.
Oh yeah, you can do that too.
Hi. So I was wondering, does it ever get like kind of lonely just having your job be sitting at home and like writing all day and not working with other people? Because I know like being an author is such a dream, but I also imagine sort of get hard in that way sometimes.
That's also like doubly poignant now, isn't it? But I actually do have a day job as well, and so I do see people all day. I work at a school. But even if that wasn't true, I think that's what opportunities like Girls Right Now and places where you can meet creative people and have like weekly, you know, you can fill your life with all sorts of things. I think the most important thing as a writer is to remember to be a regular human a lot of the time and that you have to live in order to have something to write about. So not just shutting yourself away all the time. And then again, it's a balancing act of really protecting the time that you do have to write and not, it's easy sometimes to be like, oh, it's just my writing time. I'm gonna go see a friend or I'm gonna go for a run instead. But it's important to say like, no, if this is a job, then it's like another job. And from 9 until noon or whatever, that's my writing time. But yeah, I think having a community of writers and other creative friends has been the most sustaining aspect for me as a writer. I see another question. Is it best to do most of the historical research before starting to write the first draft? I think, I don't think you're gonna know what most of the research is until you start writing the book. I think it's, again, you have to know a lot about the time period you're wanting to write about. But for example, if you wanted to write about a nurse in World War I, you would at first have to do a lot of research about what a nurse's job was in World War I. You'd have to think about where she was stationed and when the battles were at that place. But then once you get to know her and you find out that maybe her sister is against the war and she's protesting, then you're gonna have to research that. And you might not know that when you start the manuscript. So it's this duality of discovering as you write, which is the fun part for us as fiction writers, you know, the imagination. And then that leads you to, I often have like Google open, or I'm constantly getting books from the library when I'm working on a project. When you're writing a novel, this is the next question, is it more important to develop the character or develop the plot? That's kind of a trick question, because really the plot and the character are the same thing. I think that the character is most important, but the plot is made up of all of the choices that a character makes. So the more firmly you understand a character, the more firmly you can understand the choices that she might make. And we're gonna talk about that in the exercise when we're writing a scene. But I think that it's always helpful to know when you're writing as a fiction writer, is this happening to my character, or is my character causing this to happen as a result of some choice that they are making? So are they passive or are they active in the story? And if they're always active in some way, of course, things will happen to them, but their reaction to it, that's all informed by who they are and what you know about them as a human being. So always start with what kind of person they are. How do you not get bogged down in the details? In order to write historical fiction, I get so nervous about anachronisms, did I pronounce that correctly? That I get stuck before I start. That's a really good question. I mean, it's hard. I think sometimes with a project, you can get in your own way. And I definitely do this all the time where I'm writing and I'm just thinking like, this is so bad. What am I even doing? But again, it comes down to the character. People are people no matter where they were in time. And so if you think about what your character wants, and I'm talking big picture, like, do they want to fall in love? Do they want to move to the country? Do they want, like, what is their dream? And you think about that person and what they're going through. And then you start to think of a scene. Then the details, you still need to look them up, but the person's wants and needs are going to be consistent. And that's what should lead you through your scene. And the details should not be the only factor of the story. Like, it's a historical fiction story is just as much a realistic story as a contemporary story. Of course, if you're writing about something like a historical event, like war, it couldn't have happened at any other time. So it's important to think about how the historical events are pressing on the story. But I often leave, like, I put dashes in when I have to research something and I don't want to break a flow. It's like, I have no idea what kind of soap they would use. We'll look that up later, and not getting in your own way, you know? Is it difficult to develop the voice of a character so that they speak in the way people did during that time period? I find that really fun to look up slang and things like that. Old movies are great. And since this is set in the 50s, I read a lot of women's magazines from that time to think about the way either women would be talking or the sort of messages they're receiving about beauty. And man, they were not what we believe now. There's some really bad dating advice in those magazines, and they're really fun to read, but they're, I think it's, you have to think of their voice, but again, I would not, there's a phrase, perfect is the enemy of good. And I think especially in a first draft, remember that no one likes their first draft. That's why it's called a first draft. And if you're thinking about making it perfect, then you're never going to finish anything. And it's like, who cares if there are some factual errors? You have time to fix it. That's why you spend so long working on something on your own. And thinking about books on the shelf, like your favorite books, it's really good to learn to write, but you should also remember that they spent years on that and multiple people whose entire job it is to read, check the facts, do all these things, they worked on those books too. So if your first draft doesn't look like that, well, nobody's does. So again, yeah, just being like forgiving of yourself. And one more question. I did, this is, do you outline your novel before you write it? And how detailed is that outline? I have an idea, but everybody's different. I think some people really like to discover as they write. I have friends who have no idea what's going to happen in their story when they sit down to write it, and every sentence comes out of the one previous. I like to know where the characters are going, but I still get surprised. I think that that's something that you'll discover on your own if it works for you or if it doesn't work for you. Sometimes outlines can feel restrictive to writers, or if you're someone who really likes to discover the story, you can feel like it's already written if you've outlined the whole book. For others, not having an outline feels daunting and they don't know where to go. So I think that's really a personal decision. Okay, so I'm gonna talk a little bit about the exercise that we're gonna do, which is helping to build all these details that we talked about before writing a historical fiction scene. So we're gonna start thinking about the metaphor that I used earlier of set dressing. So all the details that'll be on the set in your scene, we'll start with those things and then we go inward to thinking about a character in this time before we begin a scene. This class is also called Historical Fiction and Taboo, and I just wanna talk a little bit about values when we're talking about the past. So a tender thing is about a couple different things where it's a musical and it's about an interracial relationship. And I said it in the 50s to talk about how they felt about those relationships then. Now, if you're thinking about a time period, you might want to think about what is a value that you find important now and how it might have been thought of differently in the past. And using the past to examine things like relationships or race or gender identity or sexual identity. All these things have changed a lot in the last several decades. And so looking at them through the past can be a really good way to examine them in the present. So let's start with the first exercise. So if you're gonna write on a screen, you can pull that up. And if you're gonna write on paper, here we go. Okay. So this is when we're gonna begin by just jotting down a lot of details, and then we're gonna have a chance to share before we start writing sentences that will become a scene. So don't worry yet about making something sound good. So this is called memory mining. And we're gonna start, in case you didn't, you can pick a year in the past, and it can either be from a historical event that you find interesting, or even a memory of your own from your own life, because, you know, 2005 is the past as well. You can think of a time, just any time in the past. It doesn't have to be the distant past, so that you don't have to do a ton of research while we're here tonight. So pick a memory and then just write down the practical details of that place, or that time and place. Where was it? What year was it? So you can read this slide yourself. But as you can see, these details are important to think about how a place looked and just the big broad brushstrokes of what was happening. So for example, if you're going to pick 1958, there's President Eisenhower, and you can think about the kinds of clothes that they're going to wear. They go to see the movie The Fly in theaters in the book, which was a popular movie at the time. So just go through and just make a messy list of everything you can think of from this time period. And if you have any questions, feel free to message me directly. And again, this can be from any time period you want, as long as it's not 2020. You're welcome to Google something if that helps too. Blue skies smiling at me.
nothing but blue skies do I see. Blue birds singing a song, nothing but blue birds all day long. Never saw the sun shining so bright, never saw things going so right. Noticing the days hurrying by, when you're in love, my, how they fly. Blue days, all of them gone, nothing but blue skies from now on. Yeah. jumping, and the cotton is high. Till that morning, there's nothing can harm you. Yeah, sweet daddy and mommy standing by. Story is much too sad to be told, but practically everything leaves me totally cold. The only exception I know is the case when I'm out on a quiet spree, fighting vainly the old ennui.
Just to finish up, do you have any more last things to jot down?
Your fabulous face. I get no kick from champagne. Mere alcohol doesn't thrill me.
Okay. I did something to my screen, so I can't see everybody. okay. Sorry, I like detached the chat from the edge of the screen. I don't know what happened. So now that you've made a little list, I don't know if anybody wants to share. You can either write me privately in the chat if you like to share anonymously. Or does everybody know how to raise their hand? Are there any mentees here tonight? If you write in the chat, I'm a mentee and I'd like to share, I can call on you. Otherwise, we'll just leave it up for grabs. You're welcome to read it out loud yourself, or I can read it for you. Come on. Nobody? I'll just say quickly, I picked the year 1919. Oh, perfect. Okay. Sapita, would you like to read it out loud? Oh, Caitlin, sorry, you wrote first, you're a mentee. Can you share, please? You want to talk out loud?
Yeah, sure. Okay. So we learned in my history class about the Tiananmen Square massacres, where a bunch of protesters in China were killed really brutally after democracy protests. And so we watched this documentary about it, and it really like stuck with me and almost like very much shook people in my grade. And so I wrote down and researched some things that I already knew or looked up things that were happening during this time. So that same year, the Berlin Wall came down, the World Wide Web was invented. There was the Little Mermaid, the first episode of The Simpsons, movies like Beetlejuice, Madonna, Prince Charles, and Princess Diana were a thing. So that's what I researched.
Those are some great details. That was a big year. All right, Sapita, do you want to go next? Am I pronouncing your name correctly?
Hey, yeah, Sapita. Hi.
For sharing.
Of course. I thought what was interesting is I'm working on a piece that takes place in Iran during the Iranian Revolution, like right before the Iranian Revolution. And what's interesting is that it was actually, women were so much more free back then. And actually in the 1930s, the king had banned all headscarves. And when Khomeini came into power in 79, he said that no matter where you're from, what religion you are, everyone is required to wear a headscarf. So a lot of my early research has been, you know, the ways, apart from what I already know, of how pop culture, how they're, you know, affected the way that people lived, the way that the feminist movement in Iran back then. They tried in 1976 to stop women from going to school, but then there was kind of a women's revolt, and the government agreed that educated men and women equally would only, you know, help them. It would advance their country and their economy and everything. So it's just interesting now, because even though things have slightly shifted since the 2009 Green Revolution, and a few years ago there was another attempt at a revolution, it's still, it's still so much further behind than it was back then.
So you can see how, like, you can write something in the past, and then thinking about now, it would make the time, what's going on now, even more apparent. So the first step is like a lot about big values or things that people were talking about at the time, like the big forces acting on your character, as well as things like pop culture, like the messages all around them. So what they're seeing, what they're interacting with politically, artistically, the kind of things that everybody is dealing with. Oh my, you wanna share? We actually have to move on, but you can share next. We're gonna do one more and then you can share next time, okay? So here is the second part of the exercise. And Maya, you actually know this exercise because we've done it together. But this next part is we're thinking about who we're going to write about. So now that you've thought about the big things all around this person, just pick like any human being that you can think of. They can be based on you if you want, or they can be totally fictional. So first think about just a person, their age, think about if they have siblings, are they affluent, are they not affluent, are they in school, are they working, all these kinds of big things. And then this is the most important question, I think, is number two. What do they want? And since we're going to be writing a scene, you should think of two things. You think of their big want. So that, if you're talking about a novel, would be the thing that they want for the whole book. So in A Tender Thing, Eleanor wants to be a Broadway star. That's her big want. And then in every scene, she wants something smaller. So what is the thing that in this scene they want? Do they want to convince their mom to let them go to the movies? Do they want to leave school for the day and go get candy with their friends at a cafe? Something like that. That what are they trying to accomplish here, now, right now? And it's interesting if you think about how the time period might affect the things that they want. So using the example of the Iranian Revolution, if the big picture is about going to school, that's gonna be a different question than if we're writing about a woman in New York in 2020. So taking all these things into account, then you think of character B, who is the person opposite them in their scene, their mom, their friend, their teacher, something that they're trying to, that person is in the way, not giving them what they want. Character A has to get something from character B. And you should also know what character B wants. This doesn't necessarily have to appear in your scene, but it's going to inform why or why not, why they give character A what they want or why they don't give character A what they want. So please let me know if that does not make sense. If you have any questions, and then write away until 6:56, and then we'll share and clap for the essential workers at 7.
Autumn in New York, that brings the promise of it to care for me. Not if you care for me. Stay, little Valentine, stay. Each day is Valentine's Day. Is your figure less than Greek? Is your mouth smart, but don't change your hair for me, not if you care. Got a crush on someone. Guess who I've got a crush on? You, sweetie pie, all the day and night time, hear me sigh. The least notion that I could fall with so much emotion. Could you coo? Could you care for a cunning cottage we could share? The world will pardon my mush, 'cause I've got a crush, my baby, on you. How glad a million ladies, from millionaires to caddies, would be to capture me. But you had such persistence, you wore down my resistance. I fell, and it was swell. You're my big and brave and handsome Romeo. How I won you, I shall never, never know. It's not that you're attractive, but oh, my heart grew active when you came into view. I've got a crush on you.
Okay. My, if you want to share, you can. Do you want to share?
I wrote more of like a short story. I don't know if I should like narrate it or put it in the chat.
Why don't you first tell us what you wrote about and like what details you used from the first exercise maybe, and then tell us about your character?
Sure, yeah. I chose for my topic the Titanic because I thought it was like, I've always been fascinated by like what exactly happened and the characters and the whole dynamic of class at the time of the event. So I chose to write about a young woman who was aboard the ship, and she was in the wealthy class. So she was staying in like the upper decks, and basically had her whole life made for her. And I chose to write about the time when the ship hit the iceberg and how that affected her, and it opened her eyes to the other people struggling as well. So I don't know. It was a bit long. I don't know if I should read it or.
we're gonna have a chance to share the scenes we wrote after this. So let's see if anybody else wants to share their character. Anybody? I know somebody does. Eliza?
Hi. So character A is a young girl, and she's 15, and she's lived a very sheltered life in Chinatown. Her parents are divorced, her dad is working nights, so there's kind of no parents around, and the grandparents are trying to be parents, which are hard because they came from China, and they just don't understand how New York City kids are running around doing things. And she yearns to be able to just be a kid, like she sees on TV and the books that she reads. And the only freedom she has is where she can go to the library by herself, because she doesn't have to cross any streets. She just walks down the block, makes a right, and makes another right, and the library is there. And after several escorted trips, that's the only place her grandparents would let her go by herself. So she goes every day. So she's like a nerdy dweeby kid.
Wow. What year is this set? Is this
1978.
Very cool. I like how fleshed out that is and how you really can see her beginning her. So what is she trying to get in this scene?
With the other place that her grandparents let her go by herself is a youth center, because mm-hmm. she's got a summer job there. So she just loves it. I can cross the street to my job, or I could go to the library. And those are her two freedom, quote unquote, places from the restrictions. And then character B is a boy that's at the youth center. And this youth center has a gang outreach program. And this boy is in this program. So she sees him, he's kind of tough, he's bad. When everyone else is around, he's bad. But there's been occasions where none of the other boys are around that he's actually okay, kind of nice, not a jerk.
Mm-hmm. And she wants to talk to him?
Kind of not sure about that.
Okay. That's great. Well, it's 7:00, so it is time to clap for the essential workers.
Yay. I'm unmuting everyone. It's not so weird.
It's like when mommy was, and I were talking and said, exactly lunchtime.
Okay. I see Luna had a question. Do you want to ask your question before we move on?
Yeah, I just had a question, what happens if, I haven't fleshed out a story or a conflict or anything, but I was, really interested in the fact that the Empire State Building was built during the Great Depression, and it was, for 40 years, it was the tallest building in the world, and then when the first World Trade Center tower was built in 1970, so I was curious on, how you write. If I wanted the character to be alive in 1931 when it was built, and when the World Trade Center was built in 1970, how do you I guess since the time periods keep on changing, how do you make how does that work, or how do you make sure that you're keeping up with the different time periods as you're writing the story, I guess, or since there's so much change going on, how do you make sure?
Is your question how to write more than one time period and how to do the research for that? Because I guess your character would be much pretty old. But I mean, it's really just you have to do the research of two two time periods, but, right?
Like, would you, do you think that, like, you would need to, like, also, like, research all the times in between? Otherwise, it would be, like, a really dramatic jump.
Life that person had lived. So yeah, it's important to know sort of where they were in their life, but if you're not going to be writing about that, you don't need to know every single detail, but you would want to know, for example, where they were in World War II, what their life was like in the 50s, what their life was like in the 60s, if they had children, if they got married, these things, that if you think about who they are in 1970, everything that they did before then brought them to that place. So you have to think about that. But again, like, perfect is the enemy of good. So start with, like, you know, the scenes you're writing and then fill them out with the details. But it's, again, it's about knowing the person you're writing. Not like a character in a textbook, but a person, like, as though you're meeting someone from history and you're asking them questions and you're thinking about the life they lived. Because people don't think in terms of the world events unless they had a bearing on their actual life, you know. People think about their families and what their houses were like and what their jobs were like and those sorts of things. Great, so now we are going to write a scene. So we're going to take the characters from characters A and B, and we're going to construct a scene using the wants that you thought of last time. And if you can, you should try to think about some of the details that you thought of in the exercise one and how you can use them to flesh out the work in the scene. And by the end of the scene, something should have changed. They don't need to get what they want, but they should maybe realize something about character B or about themselves, anything. Just the end of the story is not the same as the beginning. And if you don't finish, obviously, you can keep this exercise and work on it later. So let's begin. We're going to write until 7:12 or 7:14. Okay.
Sense
cause you keep me in suspense and you know it. Then you promise to return. When you don't, I really burn. Well, I guess I'll never learn, and I show it. If you got a heart, and if you're kind, and don't keep us apart, make up your mind. You're undecided now, so what are you gonna do? Now, if you don't love me, I wish you'd say so. I love you so much, honey, I just got to know. I'm just a fool for you. What are you gonna do? The way you wear your hat, the way you sip your tea, the memory of all that. No, no, they can't take that away from me. The way your smile just beams, the way you sing off key, the way you haunt my dreams. No, no, they can't take that away from me. We may never, never meet again on the bumpy road to love. Still, I'll always, always keep the memory of the way you hold your knife, the way we dance till three, the way you've changed my life. No, no, they can't take that away from me. No, they can't take that away from me.
The way you wear your hat, the way you sip your tea, the memory of all that. No, no, they can't take that away from me. The way your smile just beams, the way you sing off key, the way you haunt my dreams. No, no, you can't take that away from me. We may never, never meet again on the bumpy road to love. Still, I always, always keep the memory of us. The way you hold your knife, the way we dance till three, the way you change my life. No, no, they can't take that away from me. No, they can't take that away from me. Swing it, boys.
On the bumpy road.
change my life. No, no, they can't take that away from me.
No, they can't take that away from me.
Will you repeat that again, dearie, please?
No, they can't take that away from me. Mighty fine music, the murmur of a morning breeze up there, the rattle of the milkman on the stair. Sure, that's music, mighty fine music, the singing of a sparrow in the sky, the perking of the coffee pot right nearby. There's my favorite melody. You're my angel. Mighty fine music. And anytime I think my world is wrong, I get me out of bed and sing this song. Bamba dee dee doo dee doo wah wah dee dee. I hear music, mighty fine music. The murmur of the morning breeze up there, the rattle of the milkman on the stair. Sugar, what is music? Mighty fine music. The singing of the sparrow in the sky, the perking of the coffee right nearby. There's my favorite melody. You, my angel.
Hey. Great. So we can also share this exercise, I believe, online if you're part of Girls right now, so that you can work on something at home. But before we share, I just want to say this is like a really good way to just let you feel like you have a handle on a period before you write a scene, so that those questions about like, what do I do? Like, they don't hold you back. And obviously you have more research to do later, but these are just a good starting point so that you can find a way into the character, and that character will lead you through the rest of the questions. Once you know who you're writing about, you can start to understand the questions that you'll need to know the answers to in order to write a fleshed out story about them.